More than 200 years ago, Americans fought a revolution. A revolution against big government.
He has erected a multitude of new offices and has sent hither swarms of officials to harass our people and eat out their substance.
George III and his bureaucrats taxed and controlled their lives until the people said, enough.
Hi, I'm Susan King, and welcome to On Second Thought. I'm here on the steps of the state capitol in Madison, Wisconsin, co-hosting today's On Second Thought, and as we all know, the good guy in the white hat, William Wagner, your host.
Thank you, Susan King. It's so good to have Susan here with us on the show. Well, today we take you to June 12th, 2004, in Wisconsin. Fed up with the injustice in family court and very angry, Wisconsin fathers rallied on the steps of the Wisconsin State Capitol building. Susan King and I were there to hear their just complaints against the federally funded family destruction system, known to divorce attorneys as their biggest cash cow, also known as family court, where the good, bad, or ugly women learn to toss their marriage out the window and use their babies for profit. Yet the judges pretend that they're doing what amounts to a fatherectomy, separating and destroying the father-child relationship, is always in the best interest of the children. In the best interest of the children. Listen to men who were good dads separated from their children under the, quote, no-fault divorce laws, which have become the means to destroy rather than repair strained marriages at a big, big profit. Listen. Did you lose custody of your children?
No, I did not. I have joint custody with my children, but it is on an extremely limited schedule. My ex-wife works nights, I work days, but yet I can only see my children every other weekend. And even in court-ordered, in my marital settlement agreement, certain holidays and that stuff, my ex-wife has completely ignored the marital settlement agreement. She does what she wants, when she wants, however she wants.
Does this seem fair to you?
Does it seem fair to me? How blunt do you want me to be in that answer? It is really fucked up, okay? The system is not fair in any way, shape, or form. You know, I swear because of the fact that I don't have the right chromosome makeup, I'm at a disadvantage every time I walk into a court. I can't afford an attorney. I have found that attorneys are worthless. I have done better work on my own in dealing with friends of other fathers like myself that have been shortchanged by the legal system in fighting it, in fighting the battle myself.
To most people who have not been through family court, do they have any inkling of how biased and unfair it is?
Many fathers, to put it bluntly, are very ignorant. They don't know. They accept. They trust their attorney is going to fight their side, and they don't fight their side. Me and a few other individuals from the Eau Claire, Wisconsin area inform these fathers of what rights they have. They're pissed because their attorney didn't do them right, and they want us to help. They want us to help them out.
So how much money did you spend on an attorney?
Was $19,000.
And did it do you any good?
No, it didn't. And then I was stuck with half of the guardian ad litem fees in my divorce, which my attorney assured me that it should have been pretty much open and shut, that I should get 50-50 placement. Yeah, right. Boy, was I wrong. Now she's in corporate counsel at the courthouse, so when I have to deal with child support battles now, I'm dealing with the guardian ad litem that already had a biased opinion to begin with. In my court case. So have I been shortchanged? Yeah. So I mean, the bill for the guardian ad litem was probably about another $6,000 or $7,000. I didn't pay her. I filed bankruptcy. She didn't do it. She didn't do me or my kids any good.
Have your children been harmed by the family courts?
I think my children have been immeasurably harmed. I tried to save. I consider myself a very spiritual person. And, you know, I guess believe in Matthew 19:26, that with God all things are possible. My ex-wife just seems to have taken a different fact on that. But when it comes to my children, my ex-wife has tried to paint me as a monster to them. And I mean, even to this day, I was divorced, it's going on almost 4 years now.
Has she made false allegations of abuse?
Oh, false allegations of abuse? Boy, that's an understatement. My restraining order, huh. I mean, I was accused of even falling asleep in front of the television when I was with my kids when my wife was gone. I guess, is that considered abuse? I mean, to be honest with you, and I don't mean to sound racially motivated here, but I felt like a black person invited to a Ku Klux Klan rally. I have found that attorneys are worthless. I have found that attorneys are worthless. I have found that attorneys are worthless.
Have your children been harmed by the family courts?
I think that my children have been immeasurably harmed.
Everybody should be treated, have their God-given rights and be treated equal as an individual. And it isn't so in this child support issue.
And every time you went paternity. Every time you went to court, you found out there was no process of law.
No, I've given up. It's a kangaroo court.
Child support, 25% for two children.
Okay, did you beat your wife, beat your children, do something that lost you custody?
No. There were all kinds of allegations of abuse, sexual abuse. And
did any of them prove to be found true by the court?
No, none of them.
We're here with John Lays at the Brown County Courthouse in Green Bay, Wisconsin. His story starts in Woods County in 1989, and then what happened? You got weekends with your children?
Weekends and every other holiday, supposedly. Supposedly 2 weeks in the summer.
And did you get those 2 weeks in the summer?
No. No, my wife took the children and ran back here to Green Bay. Actually, they live up in De Pere.
Has this made for good relations with your children?
No. The children were withheld from me. We were supposed to meet halfway between Wood County and Green Bay here, but she would never show up with the children.
She would not show up. And did the court hold her in contempt of court?
No.
On the false allegations that were proven false, or at least the judge did not take judicial note that there was any merit or truth, did the court ever hold her for perjury or fraud?
No.
So basically, they could throw whatever allegations they want at you. You lose the kids. You pay child support.
And there's absolutely no justice in the system. And that was the beginning of my saga. Okay, I had to quit my job in Marshfield, move to Green Bay in order to see my children. They were still being withheld. They were being hidden out from me at my wife's parents' house.
And did you go to court and tell the court?
I went to court and tried to get a order to enforce physical placement. They did find her guilty of not complying with the order.
And for which punishment did she get?
No punishment, just told her, you start, you know, letting him see the kids. No way did I see the kids. It is 5 years later.
And how's your relationship with the kids that she thwarted your visitations with?
I see neither of my children anymore.
Do they care to see you now? Or are they totally alienated from you?
They're completely, totally alienated from me. I have pictures I'd like to show you.
Okay. Okay, this is John Lays with your daughters. What are their names?
Mira is the eldest. That's Mira.
Okay, who's in this picture?
This is myself, my eldest daughter, Mira, and my youngest daughter, Julie.
Okay, well, how old is this picture?
This picture is approximately 4 years old.
And now you don't see them at all, they don't want to see you?
No.
How old are they now?
Mira will be 18 in September. Julie will be 16 in September.
Okay, how many years later was this picture of your daughter after the court system had had control of them?
This picture is about 2 years old.
2 years old, so they don't look very happy after the courts had given the mother total control and you'd been cut out of the equation. They look a lot less happy than...
They don't.
And what were these, school pictures?
These are school pictures, yes.
These look like pretty unhappy children, if these are school pictures. Does this bother you to think the courts have done this to you and your children?
This bothers me to no end, to realize that the court system has done this to my children.
So what can you do about it?
Apparently, the only thing I found that I can do that's really effective is to let people know what is happening in our court system to our children.
And who's the judge that now lets this go on?
The current judge in this case is Judge Kendall Kelly here at the Brown County Courthouse.
And he doesn't seem to care. Is that it?
Apparently, no.
He thinks it's fine if the mother alienates the children from the father. Is that sort of his
attitude? That is the impression I get from him.
He's never enforced his order for visitation, never offered to put her in jail for failure?
Never.
To comply. What happens if you refuse to pay child support or you don't comply?
He has taken me into court. He has found me guilty of not paying child support because I did pay a partial payment 1 month and sentenced me to 6 months in the county jail.
Does that seem like justice?
Absolutely not.
Is this the America you were willing to defend when you were a young man?
I thought America was worth defending. I find that no, I would not defend it anymore.
Based on the court fraud, the court sanctioned perjury the court allows in Judge Kelly's, and this is pandemic, you've now decided you're going to vote Libertarian this year?
Absolutely.
Did you know that there are Libertarian candidates that are making this part of their platform?
Absolutely, yes.
But you don't see Democrats and the Republicans doing anything to change the inequity?
I have contacted my local representative and my congressman. Neither one of them are even aware of this problem. But when I speak to their aides, oh, yes, my brother is going through this. The same county that won't let me see my kids, allows my wife to take them away from me, has placed a foster child with me. Here she is.
Hi, sweetie.
So,
and they pay me to take care of this child.
They pay you to take care of your foster child. But at the same time, they won't enforce your visitation orders to see your own daughters.
No, they won't.
And why do you think that is? Is there some cronyism going here? Tell me what's happening.
Okay, I believe it's because of the guardian ad litem that they appointed in this case.
Which is who?
His name is David Matthias.
And what's the connection to him?
He is an old friend of my ex's father. They used to be old drinking buddies.
So justice comes down to who's drinking buddies, and you can be cut off from your own children.
Apparently.
When you've done nothing wrong, and the same county will try to make it up to you by giving you a foster child to take care of, but you can't see your own child? Does it?
That's true. That's what is happening.
What does your foster daughter think of the situation? She said earlier that she'd been abandoned by her mother after being given placement to her mother. Do you know that to be true?
Yes, that is true.
So she was cut off from her father. Her mother then abandoned your foster daughter. And the county places Liz, is it?
Yes.
Puts Liz in your care. Pays you to take care of Liz as a foster child, while at the same time, because of the drinking buddy relationship, ignores your right to see your own children.
That is what has happened, yes.
Are you going to vote for more Democrats and Republicans to keep this, or what are you going to do about it?
I'm certainly not going to vote for any Democrats or Republicans.
Who do you think you're going to vote for this year? What side of the ticket are you going to look for?
I'll be voting the Libertarian Party.
When you were very little, what happened that you lost track of your dad?
My mom and my dad got a divorce, and I knew him when I was a little kid, when I was like 2 or 3 or something. And then they got divorced, and he ended up leaving. And my mom ended up pushing him out of my life completely. I never remembered him or anything.
Okay, Liz, then your dad was pushed out of your life by your mom. Did your mom have some mental problems or bipolar or what?
For what I know, I believe this is correct, that my mom was diagnosed when I was younger as a paranoid schizophrenic. She eventually went off her meds and she started going into hearing voices and everything. And we ended up moving to Indiana and back. And I guess my dad tried actually sending me letters and stuff and trying to meet with me and everything. But the court system wouldn't allow him to know anything. They wouldn't allow him to let me know, let him know where I was.
So the court system worked against you, even letting your father find you?
Yes.
And you recently found your father, and what happened?
Well, after my mom went through her rages, and we ended up in a homeless shelter in Green Bay, which actually was the second one we went to because she got thrown out of the other one for her problems. And so we were at that one, and she got into an argument with me. And it was just a little argument. She started pushing me around, and then she gave me a 3-inch scratch on my neck. And so then they told her that she had to leave because she wasn't welcome. That day, though, since my sister has Down syndrome, Michelle Miller, she's over 18, and my mom planned on signing her off to a group home because she can't take care of her anymore. She was unable to. So that day, they ended up coming over, which we had a planned appointment. They came over, my mom signed the forms for her, they took her, and then the police kindly asked her to leave. And then they took me to shelter care, which is a juvenile facility. Then I went into when I found out my foster father, he wasn't my foster, he became a foster parents, Kathy Lays and John Lays, and since they knew me pretty well and stuff, and we had a close relationship.
So your foster parents helped you find your biological father. What now, it's been like a decade after you were cut off from him?
I believe I was cut off when I was 2 or 3 or around there.
So it's been more than a decade.
Yes, and I am now 15, and I met my father this last winter.
Okay, do you like your biological father?
Yes, he's great, he's wonderful.
Do you wish the court hadn't cut him off from you?
Yes, I wish they wouldn't have. And,
does it make you angry at the court system that cuts you off from your own father?
Yes, it does.
Thank you for this interview.
Yep.
Well, there you had it, people. That was John Lays of Green Bay, Wisconsin. And he's a foster dad to somebody else's teenage daughter. But his ex-wife won't let him have visitations with his own daughters. And you saw right there, you saw the graphic pictures of when he was still seeing his daughters a little bit to 2 years later when his ex-wife wasn't cooperating, his daughters weren't so happy anymore. What that mom doesn't understand is when those girls grow up, they're gonna realize what their mom did to wreck the relationship, and it's gonna blow back on his ex-wife. She's gonna have daughters, they're gonna have problems because they cut the father out. And yet the court says, won't enforce his rights to see his own daughters, but they'll give him a foster daughter to raise for somebody else. Is this kooky or what? Well, that's Wisconsin. You think, well, maybe that's only in Wisconsin it's kooky. Not so. It's all over. And we want to take it back now where the Wisconsin fathers are rallying on the steps of Madison, Wisconsin, and are they angry? Listen to the guy with the white beard. He had a heart attack and a whole bunch of medical problems, and they're never going to get a dollar out of him now because they cut him off from his children when he had done nothing wrong. So let's go listen to these Wisconsin fathers, June 12th.
And the judge said immediately to go right to the Court of Appeals, and they said I wouldn't even need for hearing. And the judge, his name is Spicer, Judge Spicer. He's a friend of mine. At least I believe he's okay. And so immediately I went to the Court of Appeals. And they refused to even address the issues. They refused to address it. And I just found out that the judge finally found out about all this. Both parents, equal, men and women, both of us. My brief, they refused to address this because my address was the equal rights for men and women to grow up the children. And I've made the decision to do this for the rest of my life. I've had heart attacks. I've had at least 2 or 3 heart attacks. I've had surgeries. I've had doctors for the state, and I've had federal doctors too, because I've had heart attacks because of this. I had to go to the federal court too. And it cost them $250,000 for my ex-wife to fight with me just to see my kids. It cost them $250,000 to cost to her. You know what it cost for my county? My county is Dakota County in Minnesota.
Yeah.
They know who I am. Because you know why? It cost them because I had a heart attack and they had to make the surgeries. It cost $150,000. They had to pay it. On top of that, it's cost them another $50,000 on top of this. Because I was fighting just to have equal rights. Just to see my kids. They've taken away just about everything. They've taken away my business. It's gone. It's really a sad thing to happen. It's very bad for fathers, and it is also bad for females too. The kids, they're deserving for mothers and fathers. And they have violated me, violated other men, and most of the time, it was men. I'm tired of this. I don't care anymore. They took everything away that I ever had. But I'm going to continue to do this for the rest of my life. We have equal rights. And my brief is in the Court of Appeals, and I have lots of arguments. And my arguments, they can't beat it. And they know they can't beat it. They can't make me unequal. Because I'm a fit parent. Thank you very much.
Welcome, everyone. Thanks for coming to Madison. I'm Jan Raz. I'm the president of Wisconsin Fathers for Children and Families. We are here today to raise public awareness of how poorly Wisconsin's public policy and our court system work to support the children in divorce and paternity cases. Our laws are made by attorneys and bureaucrats for the benefit of lawyers and the social service bureaucracy. They are unnecessarily vague and intrusive into our families. We need laws that are fair, clearly defined, and uniformly enforced that benefit children and families, not lawyers and bureaucrats. Our courts are out of control. Many courts are not correctly applying the new laws that we helped to pass 4 years ago. Many judges, court commissioners, and guardian ad litem are using their authority to impose their own prejudices on our families without respecting our willingness and abilities to raise our own children, and without regard to the common sense principles of equality. The result is that fathers and their extended families, grandparents and aunts and uncles on the father's side, are being forced out of the children's lives. They are being turned into visitors, not parents. We are becoming an endangered species. This has the same effect as cutting off the children's arms or legs. God gave children two parents, So why is our legal system trying to take one of them away? The family law system is unnecessarily intrusive into our lives, often forcing one good parent to fight another good parent for the right to continue to raise your own child. Good parents should not have to beg and fight or pay huge legal fees to divorce professionals for the right to continue to parent our own children. Our laws and courts should support both parents equally and not force good parents to fight each other in our courts.
Thank you, Jan. Here's a little quote for you. This comes from a columnist for the St. Petersburg Times, Robin Bloomer, or Bloomner. She says, fathers are becoming an endangered species in part because the family courts don't fully appreciate their equal claim to their children. Sexist notions of gender roles transform too many men from engaged parent to alienated visitor. Jim's father was a role model that fathers could do all the things that mothers did in maintaining a house and raising their children. Jim, in 1987, was a co-founder of Wisconsin Fathers for Children and Families, previously known as Wisconsin Fathers for Equal Justice, along with Bill Fetzner and Bennett Stark. I don't know if Bill or Bennett are here, but if you are, I'd like to acknowledge you. Jim was the president for 6 years. He wrote numerous articles and served as editor of our Today's Dad newsletter for many years as well, and was on the board of directors most of the 17 years of this organization's existence. He has advised thousands of fathers on the All Dads Hotline, which I referred to earlier, over a 10-year period. Jim conducts personal one-on-one seminars for fathers beginning the divorce process, developing divorce and custody strategies. He's the author of the book, The Wisconsin Father's Guide to Divorce and Custody. Many consider his book the Father's Bible to navigating the treacherous straits of family court. The book was published in 1996 and now is in its second printing, updated to account for the changes in May of 2000 in Wisconsin law. Jim Novak.
Thank you very much for coming out today. My message to you is that we are either faced with hope or despair. Despair causes anger. Despair causes us to put our energy into that anger, and that anger accomplishes very much in remaining a father to your kids at divorce. Hope is always possible. Courts cannot make you do what you don't want to do. They can only coerce you or attempt to coerce you into stipulating to doing things. Most people stipulate away their rights. One point I want to make about what fathers are, the most important thing that I think fathers are, aside from all the daily activity, aside from all the sameness that exists between the parenting between mothers and fathers, is that fathers are the bridge between adolescence and adulthood. Without dads, I think children have a hard time becoming adults in our society. In the past, when fathers don't function, children end up in prisons, they end up on the street, young women end up pregnant. There's a whole list of social ills that follow from the lack of fathers in children's life. Therefore, it's in society's best interest to keep children in fathers' lives. Having joint custody, having shared placement, is the natural event of things. When two people split up from a single family, an intact family, what do you do with the children? I mean, it's not right to take them away from either parent, and consequently, you do the best that you can to have your children raised by a parent as much of the time as is possible. When I say that not giving up hope, the hope that you give up is not the hope for yourself. It's the hope that your children will have a good life. The having hope means that even if you don't get everything you want out of the court system, the next morning when you get up to shave, you'll have said, I did everything I could to make sure my children had a good life, that I had as much time that I could have with them, that I did the best job that I could do as a parent. And that is having hope. Hope is not giving up your children. Thank you so much.
It took was one false allegation of abuse, and my ex was able to take away my kids from 1 week every other week to no time at all. There's never been any evidence whatsoever that I ever abused my children, and my wife was able to take away the kids just with one false allegation.
This is William Wagner for On Second Thought. We're here in Judge Carpenter's office in what county is this?
Blair County.
Blair County, Pennsylvania. And Judge, have I paid you any money to do this interview?
No.
And are you doing it of your own free will?
Yes.
And do you give permission to broadcast this on television?
Yes.
Okay. How long have you been a judge?
15 years.
15 years. When you first came to the bench, what
Judge,
yes.
Could you pick up, please?
Yes. Okay. Hang on just a minute. I've got to get down. Hang on just a minute. Before you do this interview, Bill, I've got to touch base with my present judge and make sure that I have permission.
So, Mr. Kearns, what happened? Is the court system totally out of whack? Have we lost? Is there no justice at all in the system?
Is it possible to get justice in the family court the way the system is set up?
You won't get justice. You won't get justice.
Is it possible to get justice for your children?
You can't get justice for your children.
Do they care about your children?
They don't care about your children.
But don't they do this in the best interest of the children?
There's nothing done in the best interest of the children. It's done in the best interest of the professionals, of the divorce industry.
So the divorce industry is profiting on the pain and suffering of your children?
Of your children.
Is this America?
It's Nazi Germany. This here is... It's the most unbelievable thing.
Before this happened to you, would you have believed this sort of thing was going on?
No, I was pretty blind to the whole thing. I had no idea.
So if someone else had told you this sort of thing happened to him, you wouldn't have believed him?
Probably not. Not when it involves children. I never, ever could have believed anybody would abuse a child.
Funny when she was in kindergarten?
Kindergarten, okay.
Daughter Stephanie Kearns, how many months before she was removed from your house?
That was taken in September, just about 2 months before she was removed from the house by knife.
What year?
1996.
This is Stephanie after the courts had her?
Yes.
And how old is she in this picture?
She was just about 10 or 11 years old then.
She's 10 or 11 in this picture?
Yes.
And she weighs how much?
She went close to 230 pounds from 69 pounds 2 years before.
Is she overeating to compensate for problems?
It had nothing to do with her eating. It was the psychotropic drugs.
Psychotropic drugs did this to her?
Yes.
And the government put her on these drugs?
Yes.
Who do you think requested Christie to alter the transcript?
Judge Carpenter.
Why would he do that? To save face for himself?
Cover up for the doctors and all the abuse they did to Steph, children and youth. Everything that was removed was involving children and youth and the doctors. Or added to, I shouldn't just say removed, it was more than just removed, they had actually added testimony, paragraphs of testimony.
That wasn't actually
presented. That wasn't in the hearings. So
the whole record was doctored illegally.
Oh, it's a fabrication.
Yeah, isn't that a multiple felony?
Yeah. Yeah.
Isn't that a multiple felony on the part of the judge and children services there?
Yeah. One of the directors of children and youth who'd since left children and youth went down east to work.
Who?
What was his name?
Michael McAlpin.
Is he still here?
He took off about 3 years ago and went down. Right after I got Judge Carpenter's order, he took off and went down east to find other employment.
June 23rd, 2000 is when he left.
Yeah, it's June 23rd.
Okay. In summary, Robert, is it possible to get justice in the family court the way the system is set up?
You won't get justice. You won't get justice.
Is it possible to get justice for your children?
You can't get justice for your children.
Do they care about your children?
They don't care about your children.
But don't they do this in the best interest of the children?
There's nothing done in the best interest of children. It's done in the best interest of the professionals, the divorce industry.
So the divorce industry is profiting on the pain and suffering of your children?
Our children.
Is this America?
It's Nazi Germany. This here is it's the most unbelievable thing.
Before this happened to you, would you have believed this sort of thing was going on?
No, I was pretty blind to the whole thing. I had no idea.
So if someone else had told you this sort of thing happened to him, you wouldn't have believed him?
Probably not. Not when it involves children. I never, ever could have believed anybody would abuse a child for financial gain. I didn't believe anybody would tolerate that kind of
But you found the psychologists, the CPS workers, the people who work in the courthouse, all the divorce industry, they all do it, don't they?
They all do it. And with impunity, they know they're totally immune from any of their...
If there was a candidate or a political party, say like the Libertarian Party, that came along and said, we will reduce government massively, we will do away with these county organizations that have abused your children, we will grant 50% placement of the children with each parent upon dissolution of the relationship, and no child support transfers, but each will be required to support them when they have them. Would that be an attractive enough voting issue that you would vote for that Libertarian or Independent candidate on that issue, forgetting all other issues?
That would be enough for me. That's how bad the system is. That one issue would be enough for me. So I wound up going back into court myself, representing myself pro se, and we did a real good job. They brought numerous expert witnesses in. They were all contradicting themselves. They admitted my daughter's problems was probably post-trauma stress from the events that she went through with the marriage breakup. So as I think we went through seven hearings that ended in July or June, and I got an order from Judge Carpenter on July 14th, and he totally removed me from my daughter's life. He gave the mother full custody, but upset me, so I thought, well, anything I can do now is appeal it. So I started asking for the transcripts. Well, the first court reporter that did the first hearing, I went back to her, and she says, well, I'm busy right now. I won't be able to get your transcripts. She says, I'm doing a criminal case, a murder case. So it was months and months and months, and finally I filed an appeal in the Superior Court pro se. And she had to produce the transcripts then. Well, when she produced the first 40 pages of the first transcript, she notified me by telephone and said, I quit. She says, I resigned.
Who quit?
The court reporter quit. That was Krista Millar.
This is William Wagner from On Second Thought in St. Paul, Minnesota. Jamil, you got married after dating a certain woman for, what, 6 months, a year?
Yeah, around that amount of time, yeah.
And how long were you married?
Marriage, by the time it was effectively dissolved, lasted, I think, a little over a couple years.
And from that marriage, you had how many children?
Just one child.
And that child's name is?
It's a son named Gabriel.
Gabriel. Do you love that son?
He means everything to me. I love him with all my heart.
And normally you call him your little buddy, right?
My little buddy, my little pal. We feel that way about each other, actually.
You guys are more like buddies.
We are. Well, it's a really good feeling. I know that my level of commitment to him couldn't possibly be any higher. And I think you get back what you give. And my intentions are to be the best father I possibly can for my son. And that's the way it's working.
Now, when you got married and had this child, you were already, what, 40 years old?
Yeah.
So you married pretty late in life. You took your time. This was your first marriage.
It was actually my second marriage.
Your second marriage. Did you have any children from the first marriage?
No. I had married my high school sweetheart, and we had a very amicable divorce. She did not want to have children.
And you did?
When I started reaching my mid-30s, late 30s, I really realized that I had accomplished everything I'd wanted for myself, and that having a child was something that I felt that I wanted.
Is it true your stepson had some pretty serious problems, and yet your child, by the referee's order, spends more time with the mother and that dysfunctional stepchild than they do with you? Is that not true?
Gabriel has a half-brother, and I was his stepfather, effectively. And so he was kind of a Pandora's box. His mother never represented his behaviors to me, which turned out to be pretty crazy. Highly sexualized, highly violent. As a matter of fact, I got him into therapy. In a year and a half, I had him seeing a good therapist about 30 times. And his behaviors became very well known to me as a result of that. It was a very hard child to control from the point of view of him not misbehaving in school and things like that. To answer your question, the marriage dissolved when the mother determined to go back home where she had come from, which was up north here in Minnesota, a couple hours, took Gabriel with her, and basically I found out she was having an affair and plotting a divorce behind my back, even though she had told me that that isn't what she wanted to do.
Was the dysfunctionality of the stepchild that's not your child, but was her child by a different relationship,
was that a
significant factor in destroying your relationship with her?
It was a significant factor, but I don't really think it was the only factor. As a matter of fact, school records and therapy records show that that child was improving under my tutelage. He'd started becoming one of the best students in his class. I was helping coach his baseball teams and all this. We became quite bonded. As a matter of fact, when I learned that she was having a divorce and had no intention of staying in the marriage, that she wanted to divorce me, I filed for divorce, and that little boy was very sad that he was going to be leaving me and let me know that he wanted to stay here, actually, with me.
So her biological son, your stepson, was about 8 at the time?
Yeah.
He wanted to stay with you?
Yeah, he did.
But that never happened. Courts wouldn't allow that.
Well, she wouldn't allow it either. As a matter of fact, she removed him. And one of the last things I remember him telling me is, they're taking my bed. From this home here, they're taking my bed, and I need a bed to stay here. And I just said, I'm sorry, I can't do anything about it. And as a result of him going up north, I really haven't ever spoken to him since, which is hard. I've become a villain with that kid right now, alienated from him, effectively, from the notes and comments I've read.
Okay, how about your own son, Gabriel? Did the courts recognize, or the court referee recognize, that this was your son, and that possibly this son was in danger from the older half-sibling? Did they ever recognize that?
Well, whether or not they recognized it, if they were presented with the information, cold hard facts, which showed that Gabriel was and is at risk, there was no denying that that was done through the entire course of the proceedings. We presented numerous, actually voluminous amount of documentation showing that Gabriel's half-brother is a predator, a violent, sexual, highly sexualized predator, actually, who people he has come into contact with in his mother's environment up north have actually been removed due to CHIPS petitions, Children in Need of Protective Services. The way I've looked at it is the county down here has removed my son from me and given Gabriel as a replacement to the community up there, where that community is removing children from that family. So I've lost my son, who's now up there, where they've lost their children due to CHIPS orders.
And you still maintain a home here? You have a place? Your son has his own bedroom.
I help people right now who are going through this kind of thing, who can't believe it. I give them a quick wake-up call. And basically what I tell them is that if they want to understand what's happening, just follow the money. Just follow the money trail and you'll understand. A lot of times they don't understand why this is happening to their children. And I say, look, it's got nothing to do with the children. It's got everything to do with money. Follow the money trail.
You know, you submitted a challenge to the referee, to a higher court, and so did your attorney, didn't you?
Well, that the challenge, we appealed to the appeals court in Minnesota, where they just gave the referee great discretion. We appealed to the Supreme Court. They wouldn't hear the case. But my attorney filed a complaint to the Board on Judicial Standards, as I did. We both filed formal complaints. It's very unusual for an attorney to actually file a complaint. They usually just go along to get along and do their own thing.
What's your attorney's name?
Mark Nygaard.
And did he submitting this motion make any better result than you submitting a motion to the appeals court? Or to the committee on standards, did it make any difference?
No.
So the system is broke.
It's absolutely broken. Everybody's shocked. And the facts are right there, and it doesn't seem to matter that we've got malfeasance on behalf of judicial officials and nonfeasance on behalf of this Board on Judicial Standards, and nobody cares.
Now I'm going to take you in the same summer of 2004 to the state of North Carolina. How do you feel if you're a struggling young black man and you're good at sports and you go out for football, you get into the majors, and voila, you get to be a quarterback. You go work hard. You throw that ball, you're a great quarterback, you start making big money, you got the house, you got the big house, you got money in the bank, and then as a successful young black man in sports, you go back to your home turf, marry a girl you knew in high school, and you think, she understands me because she's from the neighborhood. And you think, all will be well. Well, that's Super Bowl quarterback winner. And here's Tim, the great Super Bowl Dolphin quarterback who won a Super Bowl in 1986. Just a great guy, a real, you know, macho sports guy. And he's got two sons that he should be raising. He had been raising. They were doing fine in school. They were getting good grades, were well adjusted. And he was, get this, he was a 24/7 dad. Because even though his ex-wife had stripped him of the house and cash money and all that kind of stuff, he still had some residual income coming in. So he was able to buy a house that cost about 1/4 as much as the one his wife got. And by the way, he'll tell you, when he married his wife, she came with debt, student loans, credit cards that needed to be paid off. But when she left with money in her pockets and let him have the two kids. Actually, maybe she didn't let him have the two kids. Maybe the court refused to let her have them, but gave her everything else she wanted, and she's a CPA. Let's listen to Tim. You're a Super Bowl star, right?
Got the ring to
you
prove it.
You got the ring to prove it. And you guys never have any problems, right? You get married, you have kids, and everything is wonderful.
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily.
That has not been the case.
Not in your case anymore.
Not nowhere near the case, William. I'm absolutely stunned.
Tell me what
shocked.
Happened. Tell me what happened.
Well, basically, you know, I did what most men are taught. You go, you work hard, you make a life, you build a home, you be a man, you provide, then you go get a wife. No one ever told me that on the way out, you could lose everything you work for at a judge's whim. It's called wide discretion, and that's exactly what happened to me.
Wide discretion of the judge.
Very wide discretion.
Okay, yeah.
Absolutely took everything that I had. I had $1 million estate, William, that the courts gave away. But let me tell you what they did, which is so crazy.
When did you get married? After that Super Bowl?
Oh, no. I was in the NFL 5 years prior to marriage. I had a sizable estate prior to marriage.
You had a what? A $500,000 house?
Lakefront home.
Lakefront?
Mercedes Benz, property in California. Oh, man, I needed to get married like I needed another hole in my head. But that's not what we're taught. I went and brought a woman home, and it didn't work out. So on the way out, everything that I worked so hard for is taken from me.
Is that fair?
It's not. And the thing about it, see, I have two male children. What do you tell your male children when you sitting here and you've just been jacked by the system? What do you teach them? How do you teach these young boys to
respect the law?
Respect the law, respect. What do you tell these kids when they work their butts off? I mean, I got two sons. They work their tails off. And then they attain a life. Then they get married. It don't work out. And there's a 50% chance it won't. Everything is taken from these courts are so anti-man. It's just ridiculous. I didn't believe it. And most men, I'm telling you, out there, and you're saying, oh, he's just another bitter man. You just an angry female, or your woman decided she don't want you, your butt away from being jacked.
Tell me, when did you get started in the football, the National League? What year did you start? You were a rookie in what year?
1986. I was a rookie from Texas Arlington.
Okay.
Who'd
you play for?
I played for a draft by the San Francisco 49ers.
And when's the first Super Bowl you won?
Super Bowl 23, the one in Miami. You remember that game.
Down from the 33 and nearly picked off. A risky pass. Tim McKeyer, the former 49er, on a pass intended.
It was a free shot for McKeyer. He had Lewis Oliver in the zone behind him, and he had an opportunity to get that into the end zone. He came close.
Well, I don't know what McKeyer read here, but he either read Schrader or he read Fernandez, because he makes his break before the ball is even released. Tim McKeyer must have spent some hours in front of the projector this week going over the tapes. He saw something and reacted.
You remember that game with...
There's so many of games.
But no, really, it was Super Bowl 23. Then we went back Super Bowl 24 in New Orleans and beat Denver 55-10. So had a very wonderful career, made a lot of money, did a lot of things.
What did you make when you won? Well, Tim McKeyer, Super Bowl champ, 1986. Played for the 49ers, played for the Dolphins. What do you think of that? Is it right that he lose everything and only have his residual income? He gets the two kids and then they take the kids away from him. By the way, that just happened this past September. The judge ordered when they started the new school year, they had to be in mom's house. So come September, even though the kids were with him when we did that interview in the summer of 2004, come September, with dad doing nothing wrong, with Tim McKeyer being a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week dad, totally focused on his kids. He got their lunches, got them off for school in the morning, was there to meet them when they got off the bus in the evening, without doing anything wrong. The judge says, oops, I think we'll take the kids away and give them to mom because now she wants them. When she didn't qualify to have them in the beginning, now she wants them. So they take everything else around, and now they want, I don't know if this is true, But Tim says his ex-wife actually wanted to have him go back and play football again. Now, wait a minute. It's now, two decades later since he won the Super Bowl in 86, and she wants him to go back and be instantly making that kind of money again? Any football guys out there know, does that ever happen?
Marry someone that don't have them. Marry someone who hates her father, don't know her. Go ahead, take your chance. I guarantee you, on the way out, you will pay, and there's a 50% chance that that marriage won't work out. So you're taking a 50% chance on everything that you work for, on this person, with all these negative things against, the very important factors that a man should consider before he chooses a life partner. If you overlook them, you will pay, because these courts don't care nothing about you, period.
That sounds like pretty good fatherly advice, Tim.
It is. It absolutely
is. Did anybody give you that advice?
No, no one told me nothing. I am learning as I go.
The hard way.
The hard way.
The expensive way.
Very expensive lesson that I learned.
And she lost a $700,000 house. Plus, I imagine the court gave her some cash to take care of that house.
No.
But you got the kids. You got your two sons.
Someone can explain to me how a man is awarded sole custody of two children, two male children, two boys, but not awarded no cash. The judge did not order me any cash from my $1.45 million estate. None. Prior to, even when we separated, the missus, we counted out $125,000 cash that she got, including the cash that she went to the bank, unbeknownst to me, made a friendly withdrawal. Why? I got rights. What these courts and these family laws and this divorce industry has done to men is ridiculous. It's systematically destroying men and putting them at the whims of emotional, contemptible, angry females. And these women have a protocol. First thing they're gonna do is get a domestic violence argument against you. And secondly, they're gonna accuse you of doing something to the children. Thirdly, they're gonna take all the money, go get a lawyer, the best lawyer money can buy. And guess who's gonna finance it all? I don't know about you, but I'm financing my entire divorce.
So you're financing your own destruction?
Yes. Literally.
It seems insane.
Literally. She came with her clothes, with her student loans, with her credit card debt, with her inability to take care of herself, to my lakefront home. And on the way out, with me having sole custody people, gets everything. They gave the non-custodial parent the $700,000 paid for house. They gave the non-custodial parent all of the cash. And I'm not gonna tell you her behavior, since she lost custody. No cooperation, took him to the doctor without talking, wouldn't talk to me, no communication whatsoever. So the court said, well, since she's raising and kicking up this much dust, we'll give her custody back. That's what just happened to me recently, April 6th, after raising my boys 3 years, great in school, excellent grades, all very well-mannered children. You saw yourself, yeah, William.
Right.
This court, this female judge decided, I call her your mommy, not your honor, your mommy. Because she has three boys, one of them the same age, but your mommy said, I'm gonna give the children back to their mother because she's their mother and she loved those boys. What does that have to do with a substantial change in circumstance that adversely affect the children? Your mommy? Crazy, man. It's crazy.
Tell me, did you ever interfere with her visitation with the children?
No.
Tell us what her visitation rights were like. Just give us a skip.
She had very liberal visitation. She had 3 weekends of the month that she chose whenever she wanted. She got 6 consecutive weeks during the summer. Did you hear me?
Yes.
6 consecutive, and guess what, people? Didn't see my boys one day during those 6 weeks, and was lucky in those 6 weeks to get 5 hours worth of conversation with them in 6 weeks. Very liberal visitation. Extremely. Matter of fact, too. Plus, there's a third wheel in our divorce. It's called her mother. The court had found her mother to be a detrimental influence and a source of conflict to the family and me, and she harms my relationship with my sons. So the female judge, your mommy, takes them from her and gives them to the mother, who the detrimental mom lives with her now. They live together now, all on that $700,000 house that she went and bought in the ritzy part of town, and having a wonderful life off of my efforts. My 12-year career was for my ex. It was not for Tim McKay. I did not work for men. I did not work for my posterity. The court said I had worked for my ex-wife and her mother. That's what I spent my 12 years in the NFL for.
That was Tim McKay. Thanks, Tim, for a great interview. Now, what you don't know is even after the father's been emotionally destroyed, stripped of his kids, thrown in jail for just saying, "Hi, kids," that's all it takes, or failure only making a partial payment on child support, there's 100,000 dads any given day of the week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, sitting in some state prison or some county jail, and they're not accounted for as part of the prison population. But 100,000 dads, and they're different dads every month, for failure to pay child support, even when the courts have destroyed them, left them homeless, no place to work, had them arrested at the job site so they lose their job, and then when they don't have a job, they throw them in jail. And I'm going to give you a guy who's that exactly what they did to him. A judge, I have to call him the lunatic judge of Indiana. I give you now Torm House. Torm House is the leader of the Indiana Fathers' Rights Movement. He's got his own website. And we did this interview in Hendricks County Jail. Thank you, Sheriff of Hendricks County. Because the judge wanted to just teach him a lesson, because he appealed the judge's ruling on several things, and the judge ignored the appeal, refused the service of subpoena, and threw him in jail. Or something like that. And I have to ask myself, is this still America? Are we living in the Soviet Union? Torm House in the Hendricks County Jail.
Screamed against this county for corruption in my child custody case. I mean, just blatant stuff. And here, a few weeks ago, they decided to schedule a contempt hearing against me, without following the procedures of setting up a rule to show cause and stuff. And regardless of all that, in Indiana, you got an automatic change of right to, or an automatic change of judge by right. Anyway, knowing that they were just gonna screw me again, I did a few things to prevent him from even having jurisdiction over this case anymore. One was to change a judge, because you got a one-time right in Indiana, with a petition to change custody or that kind of thing, something major. And I also removed the case to federal court, which removed all jurisdiction from them, at least temporarily. But this is a child custody case, of course. But you can remove cases to federal court in every state under 28 U.S.C. 1441 through 1447. But basically, when you allege violations of civil rights, you can remove cases to federal court. And if you go to my website, there's pre-packaged sets of pleadings there that people have been downloading and using to file removal packages all over the country.
So why are you in here?
So I'm in here under just pure retaliation. They refused to obey the law. The judge knew he didn't have jurisdiction over me anymore, so he ordered me to be arrested and held without bond.
He issued a bench warrant to have you arrested.
Arrested for failure to appear at a hearing he could no longer have because his jurisdiction was already taken away from him.
And what judge was this?
Bowles, Jeffrey B. Bowles.
Judge Jeffrey B. Bowles of Hendricks County?
Right. And this same judge has been known to the Indiana Supreme Court for at least 15 years, maybe 20 years, of being just out of control to the fact, to the point in 1990, they almost removed him from office back then, quoting all kinds of things that he'd done for many years as far as being abusive and retaliatory to clients, litigants, defendants, other attorneys, other judges, county politicians, how he's tried to usurp the authority of federal courts.
Have you filed a writ of habeas corpus?
I haven't done that, but I'm working just today. I'm working on a writ of mandamus and prohibition. In other words, whenever a judge exceeds their jurisdiction or acts without jurisdiction, then you can ask the high court of the state, well, at least that's the way it works in Indiana, you can ask the Supreme Court to say the judge exceeded his jurisdiction, therefore you can mandate or prohibit him under a mandamus or prohibition to order them to obey the law. You know, and in regular appeals, it would be discretionary things you have to figure out, arguments and all that kind of stuff, and how case law works out and everything. But this is a simple situation where he did not have jurisdiction, period, end of story.
Did you tell the officers when they arrested you?
Yes, they don't care.
Okay, then did you have a hearing?
I also faxed the sheriff of this county 10 minutes after the last paperwork was filed affecting the federal removal, so he did not have jurisdiction, informing the sheriff of this county. And I attached copies of the pleadings, too, so he would have the actual law, informing him in one page that this judge is known to be retaliatory and abusive, and because I removed this case away from him, I would not be surprised if he filed or ordered that I be arrested on a body attachment for failure to appear at this hearing that he was not allowed to have, and to inform the sheriff of this county that surely you're a man of integrity and you would not want to be involved in such dastardly deeds and so forth.
You did that from the jail here?
No, I did that. I did that the day before I was arrested.
Ah.
The hearing was on Wednesday the 26th, 3 weeks ago today. They arrested me the next day. They came out of the county into my county and arrested me the next day.
How do they get jurisdiction in your county?
See, I don't know that either. That doesn't seem right either. I'm not really up on that. But it doesn't seem like they have jurisdiction to... It seems like they would have to ask the sheriff of my county to come pick me up and transport me to their county or whatever. I think that's true too. But see, they didn't obey the law on not having the hearing, on his jurisdiction being removed from him, at least temporarily. Matter of fact, the change of judge under state law, see, I filed under both state and federal to make sure that he knew he didn't have jurisdiction. I put in the pleading.
Did he answer you at all? Did he give you any response?
No, of course not. He has no intention of obeying the law.
Well, then he's outside his authority. Doesn't it give you a right to sue him personally?
Yes, it does.
And attach his personal property?
Yes, when he's without jurisdiction, he loses all immunity when he acts without jurisdiction.
So how long are you going to be in here till you get your writ of mandamus?
Either that, or they've just got me sitting here for the next 30 or 40 days until just a regular review hearing that was just a normal part from a couple months ago, a review hearing from a hearing on March 9th that they had without even informing they were going to have a hearing. They didn't even inform me they were going to have a hearing, so they had a hearing, and that's what this contempt thing came from. They had a hearing on March 9th without even serving me notice of the hearing. And in that hearing, they restricted my visitation rights in violation of Indiana law, which says that you can't do that to a non-custodial parent unless there's a finding of significant emotional or physical harm or threat of harm to the children. They can't restrict existing visitation rights. There was no findings. They didn't even bother to talk about anything like that. They just decided to restrict my visitation rights to only like Sunday during the day for part of the day and Wednesday for just, you know, instead of the normal weekends and everything. So anyway, so that made it illegal already, but they didn't even serve notice of the hearing to begin with. Plus, as part of that hearing, they also decided to order me to provide name and address of an employer within 30 days from the date of that order, March 9th. Well, I also had removed the case to federal court on that same day, in between the time they had the hearing and before the order was actually issued that day. So at that point, the order, they didn't even have notice, so the hearing was illegal already. They violated the law, straight statutory law, restricting visitation rights. They can't do that. Plus, after the case was removed to federal court that day, the first time, this is the second time, that was the first time, they could no longer do anything in the case, including issuing that order later in the day, let alone it was already bogus because no notice of hearing. And so as soon as, and so that 30 days that they had ordered, I respond and give name and address of an employer, of a non-existent employer, because mm-hmm. I just got released, I was telling you earlier, from their previous false imprisonment of me. So the case was removed to federal court for something like 40 or 45 days. So it went past that 30 days. And being outside the bus lines and out in rural America, I couldn't find a job just yet. Even though I was looking.
What kind of work did you normally do, Mr. House?
I was, the last job I had, I was the CAD administrator, CAD manager, which is computer-aided drafting for the state of Indiana.
The state of Indiana was your employer?
Yeah, I was a director manager downtown at the government center in the state of Indiana, Indianapolis, and I was responsible for all state-owned assets in the entire state, all state hospitals, all state prisons, all... any kind of renovation, construction, or demolition that exceeded $25,000, which is most every single project, all those construction...
For the entire state of Indiana?
Yes. All those construction projects, plans...
You were the manager.
Well, not for the construction projects, but for all the standards and policies of all the blueprints. All the construction drawings.
They all had to come through your office.
And they all had to be due to standards and policies that I set. Yes.
Now, why did you lose that job?
Because I was arrested by these people out here falsely the last time.
And how long did they incarcerate you the last time?
A little over 2 years.
They had you locked up for 2 years?
Mostly because I had written a letter to my ex's attorney here, which happens to be the pro tem temporary judge in this same Judge Bowles court, advising her to obey the law, because she has been documented as committing many dishonest actions in this same custody case.
And what was her name?
Suzanne Conger.
That was Torm House in the Hendricks County Jail, where I interviewed him last summer. Because the judge who threw him in jail so often, he lost his good state of Indiana job and had to go to a lesser paying job when he got out and couldn't make the child support payments, so he had to move in with his mother. Lost his house because they lost custody of his kids. The courts just don't get it, and they don't care because they want to build the divorce industry up, make the lawyers rich. Those lawyers support those judges that screw the dad out of the family. And I've got an interview coming up for you in a few weeks with someone from a major federal prison who's one of the top guys, and he's telling me, I think it was 75% of the men in there were raised by moms only, where dad had been cut out of the picture completely.
Here in the state of Iowa, our legislature passed and our governor recently signed a bill. It was House File 22, and the bill states that if either parent petitions the court for joint physical care, that if the court denies joint physical care, the court needs to support the denial with facts and conclusions based upon law that joint physical care is not in the child's best interest. It's a huge milestone here for people and parents and children in the state of Iowa. I'm real proud of Governor Vilsack for going against the Iowa Bar Association and listening to the taxpayers and the people of Iowa about actually how the system has worked and how it's affected the lives of a lot of non-custodial parents and children. It was contentious. There was animosity and plenty of animosity to go around on both sides. And thankfully, over the last 3.5 years, we've come a long ways to overcome some of that animosity and raise our son.
And you really have him like half the time.
I have him exactly half the time, and he spends half the time with his mother.
And you don't have any more issues going on in court. Now, did you spend money on an attorney to get to this?
I've spent over $8,000 in attorneys and court costs.
Did that help at all?
I don't feel like it helped much.
And you have had
pretty much equal time with your son since the divorce. Is that true?
That is correct.
And is your son doing well under this arrangement?
My son is doing excellent.
And the only compromise you had to do is make sure that his mother was financially taken care of in order to get an amicable agreement. Is that basically correct?
Yeah, that's how I felt it come about, that I was able to get secure time with my son, having my son half the time in joint physical care if I met the financial demands. If I didn't meet the financial demands by then, I felt that it was going to be a all-out custody war where most likely I would have not won.
And under this has been the arrangement for what, 3 years?
It's been the arrangement for the last 3.5 years.
You were asking about how things have been since we've lived up here in Michigan. My children have gone through elementary school, middle school, and they're now in ninth grade. And for the first 8 years, they had been in private schools, engaged in all sorts of activities, soccer, field hockey, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts. They had liberal time with their mother, seeing her basically every week after school on Wednesdays. And then every first, third, and fifth weekend, effectively from Thursday out of school to Monday morning. So things have gone quite well in that regard. There's always been problems after a case like we had of the magnitude, but there's never been the kind of problems that we had in Texas. So my kids have done quite well. In fact, my daughter in particular, but both children are good students, and they've excelled at school and have done extremely well.
Now, do your children know about the false allegations their mother made?
Actually, they do, yes.
How do they feel towards their mother about that?
Well, I don't know. During the time that my children lived with me, we pretty much stayed away from this topic. What actually happened in Texas is the mother taught them to say these things, so they were actually aware of these allegations even from a very young age.
Their mother taught them to say these things of the allegations while they were in Texas?
Yes, that's true.
And they were like, what, 4 or 5 years old?
2 and 3 years old.
2 and 3, and she's teaching to make sexual allegations against you?
Well, what the court-appointed psychologist wrote in his report and testified in court is that the mother had rehearsed the children to make incriminating statements about me, and that the statements were far beyond the children's mental ability at the time, saying that everything from benign things like the father's mean or bad when they showed no fear or a concern over their father when they were with him, to more serious things of sexual allegations that took many different forms. Quite unsettling, the specific allegations.
And they were all decided by a jury to be false?
The jury decided that there was no merit to them. They gave custody to me. This wasn't some unusual outcome. It's not like the jury, you know, did something unusual. The court-appointed psychologist wrote a report saying that the allegations were unfounded, that the mother had taught the children. The children also had an attorney. They appointed an ad litem attorney who was a board-certified family law specialist. She went through the whole case and made her closing argument to the jury, and the jury made the right decision. So you asked how the children feel about this. They're aware of the allegations. I think they just find them unsettling, and there's no truth to them, so it's kind of like a bad memory for them, I suppose.
Who was the judge on that case in Texas?
The judge in the case in Texas was Dean Huckleby. I don't believe he's still on the bench anymore. He's retired.
Did he make any verbiage in his closing remarks after the jury verdict came in that he might consider setting aside the jury verdict?
Absolutely not. There were probably a half dozen different devices used to attack the jury verdict and the award of custody, And even when all those were exhausted, there was delay introduced to try and prevent the judgment from being entered. Every single attempt was denied by the judge, and the order did enter, giving me custody of the children. The interesting thing is that after the jury verdict came, there were allegations basically going on an ongoing basis. Every single allegation stopped as soon as the jury rendered their verdict. There were no further allegations, and there never have been any since.
So this judge came to the right conclusion. He didn't try to overturn it. Would you say he treated you with respect even though you were defending yourself in per se?
Initially, I had a very difficult time pro se. Part of it was my own difficulty understanding the more formal process that's used in Texas. There was also a master used. It's kind of like a referee for the initial parts of the hearing. I lost a lot of battles. I had a very difficult time, but eventually by the time we got to the trial court, I had adjusted my procedure to conform to all the formalities of the court, and I had spent thousands of hours on my case. I was almost indistinguishable from one of the other attorneys, the children's attorneys, or my ex-wife attorney, my presentation to the court.
Did the attorneys during the trial start to treat you with respect?
Actually, yeah, and the same thing happened with the court personnel.
Do you expect to prevail this time?
Absolutely, I tend to prevail.
And when do you go to court?
We've been to court. The case is now in the Michigan Court of Appeals, and things proceed rather slowly in Michigan or in any appellate court, so it'll probably be late summer before there's any decision or activity in the Court of Appeals.
And if you prevail, does that mean your children will come back home to you?
The outcome that we will be asking for is the court to reverse its decision, in which case the custody decision revert to what it was before. In other words, that there wasn't grounds to change it in the first place.
Why do you think your ex-wife is doing this? Is she still spending time being bitter after 11 years since she lost that battle in Texas? You think she's still bitter, or does she have some agenda?
Well, she's bitter, but the clear agenda, and she's made this quite known to the court and to the psychologist that was appointed up here, she intends to return to Texas with the children.
This is William Wagner for On Second Thought. We're here with Ed
Biankowski.
Ed Biankowski, you just got served with papers again, cutting off visitation with your children, is that right?
Yeah, I just went to court in February for a final. I was there for contempt for custodial interference, and I filed the contempt order, and ultimately, instead of having my visitation and custody enforced, it was a termination of my parental rights.
If there was a political party or a candidate that advocated mandatory 50% placement with each parent when they split up and no money transfers called child support, barring all other issues, if that was one of the top three issues, would you be willing to vote for that candidate?
Oh, yes, I would.
Even if it was a Democrat?
It doesn't really matter. Somebody that...
Even if it was a Republican?
It doesn't matter.
Libertarian? Green
whoever,
Party.
Whoever it is.
You would support that candidate?
I would.
What would you do for that candidate? Would you put up yard signs?
Do whatever I could. Yard signs, that's
not a problem. Gather signatures?
Yes, I would.
So this issue pretty much blows away all other issues.
Oh, absolutely, for me, because the divorce, especially for men, is a complete life-changing situation where you can literally, besides losing your children, property, houses, cars, everything, I mean, it's a complete shift and a life-changing situation. There's nothing greater that has a substantial impact on your life as a divorce, and it's far greater against fathers.
Thank you.
went door to door to all the businesses in his district and explained that to people. And they had never related their problems with the speaker, who was the most powerful man in Georgia next to the governor. And when they started, and I tied it together for them, and with a divorce rate of 50%, so many people have gone through so many problems that when I tied it together, and they looked, and they all of a sudden realized he was the root of their problem, because he had the power to change things, and he's the one to help get the laws passed.
And he was who?
House Speaker Tom Murphy.
And this brochure helped get him unseated.
Correct, it did, because it explained how he had been the one who had passed the legislation that was so much anti-father, and he was keeping any other legislation passing that would help men to be fathers.
What year did he get voted out?
Just this last year, 2002.
2002.
That's right. That was a...
Did he come around and thank you for his defeat?
No, but he wanted to fight me in front of over 200 people, in front of three, you know, video cameras, and three cops, and two reporters from the Atlanta Constitution. He sure did. He said, I don't want to talk to him. I want to go outside and fight him. Whoop him. I was standing there in this big crowd, because it's a political forum. This is after I'd done his district for 2 days. And I said, I don't fight politicians who are twice my age. And for that, they went to somebody else. He wouldn't take my question. But that's okay.